Welcome to the Pickford Classic Movie. I'm Kaveh, Askari. I teach film history at Western Washington University.
And I'm Michael Falter, program director at Pickford Film Center, and today's film is The General from 1926. This is the Buster Keaton comedy classic, kind of toward the end of the silent era. And, you know, I love silent film. I'm not that steeped in it, and I was just amazed at how fast-paced The General was, how amazing Buster Keaton's physical, not only just his comedy, but his stunts. Mm-hmm. I mean, it was just, I loved every minute of this film.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of people, you know, silent films don't get shown on television very often, and I think it's a really a rare treat that we get to do this on our show. And, you know, a lot of people think about silent films as a sort of incomplete form of cinema, that the film was primitive and then sound came along and completed film, and nothing could be further from the truth. In fact, when sound film came along, there were a whole new set of codes and standards and practices that needed to be completely reinvented, and it took years for that to happen. And at the end of the silent era, you really see this fruition of a clear sense of style in many different genres. And the genre that we're looking at today, silent film comedy, this is definitely one of the high points. You know, if our viewers haven't seen a Buster Keaton film, this is one of the ones they should definitely see. So we hope you enjoy this rare screening of a silent film. And if you like it, let us know what you think.
Welcome back to Buster Keaton's The General, and we're going to talk about a couple of my favorite scenes in our next break, but now we've seen Keaton at home in his surrounding, which is on the train, which is not really the general. It's a train that's made to look like the general, but you know, what can you say about, I don't know, the idea of things that go?
Well, you know, silent film comedy becomes, you know, throughout the silent period, becomes increasingly fascinated with the interaction between human beings and machines. You know, the spectacles become more elaborate. You know, there are these crazy cyclorama, you know, circular devices, that these kind of mechanized sets that were used in Max Sennett studios, for example. You know, Keaton's film, you know, The General, is about an interaction between a person and a machine. He's really this master operator of this engine, but you know, I think in contrast to some of the other silent film performers, Keaton has this completely different style, this fluidity. You know, Chaplin, you know, another you know, probably more famous than Keaton, Charlie Chaplin, when he interacts with the machine, it's always about these jittery, nervous gestures. You know, the machine kind of makes him twitchy and awkward, and it sort of turns his body into a machine, and you really feel that when you watch The General, that Keaton has this almost balletic relationship with the train. You know, he just sort of moves in this kind of fluid relationship with it, and it just, it really does showcase those two very different kinds of styles. And I have to say that, you know, Keaton's style is brilliant and singular, and you know, hasn't been equaled by anyone since.
Yeah, it never reminds me of Chaplin. I mean, the whole film, you know, I kind of kept expecting to wait until I saw some Chaplin-esque move, and he really has a totally unique, defined style.
Mm-hmm. And his stone face throughout the whole thing too is another one of his trademark elements,
yeah,
of his style. So look for those things in the next segment of The General.
Thank you. Welcome back to the Pickford Classic Movie. We're watching The General, Buster Keaton's classic. And Buster Keaton is Johnny Gray here. But he doesn't just act in the film. He is also the director, he is a producer, and one of the co-writers.
And does all of his own stunts as well. I mean, that's one of the things that that is a huge part of Keaton's reputation.
You know, he would do stunts that even the stuntmen would be scared to do.
Right, and the operators of the train, I mean, that iconic shot of him riding the little bar between the wheels of the train, I mean, that's something he really had to convince his train operator that it was okay to do, even though it was terribly unsafe. I mean, if the speed changed in one small way in the wrong way, he could have been ground up in the gears of the train.
Nothing in the film actually seems safe to me.
No, and in fact, I mean, it wasn't. I mean, he was very harmed bodily. I mean, in another train gag that he did, he actually injured his neck, a small fracture in his neck that he was walking around with for a while, and finally a doctor told him that this accident that you got in was a very damaging one.
And some of the other things going on in the film, Johnny Gray, Confederate engineer. It takes place during the Civil War time. Mm-hmm. He's in love with Annabelle Lee, played by Marion Mack, and she's also a very good silent film heroine, I would say.
I think so, and she works beautifully in this film. And we'll talk a little bit later about however the chemistry between them is figured. But the cast all around is terrific.
So take a look at Buster Keaton's one-man renaissance show in The General.
Welcome back to The General. Michael, I love Buster Keaton for a number of reasons, but one of the reasons is that every one of his gags, every one of his setups is like a puzzle, you know, that you can really see him thinking through the puzzle, you know, how he's going to place those railroad ties or logs on the tracks and, you know, how he's going to get out of a particular situation. And it's absolutely heightened by the fact that you're on tracks and, you know, shifting the tracks is this complicated process. And that's really there throughout his film. You really see him changing his mind or coming up with an idea or improvising on the spot. It's all about adaptation to the environment.
And he really kind of limits the number of times where something is a coincidence or something just happens, deus ex machina or something, where it just is sort of, it's just there. He actually is the creator. He is the one that's thinking about it. It doesn't demean the audience in any way, their intelligence about trying to figure out what's going to happen next. And one of my favorite scenes where I think you can see two sides of Keaton's character here as Johnny Gray, where he has the ultimate control of his environment, which is the general. And he is a master engineer. He knows exactly what it needs. He knows how much fuel it needs. I mean, the man, like you said, it's just a poetry, fluid motion between man and machine. And the scene where Annabelle Lee is attempting to help him, you know, put fuel in the general, and she finds this, you know, big, lovely piece of fuel, and it's got a little knot in the middle of it, and it's not a perfect piece of wood, so she throws it overboard. You know, and he sees this, he's like, what are you doing? And then she puts in a little tiny piece of kindling, you know, and then he picks up an even smaller piece and puts it in there, acknowledging to her that she is kind of an idiot, but he is also in love with her. And so what does he do? He, like, pretends to strangle her, and then at the same moment gives her the first kiss, and it's like, I think it's one of the most beautiful kind of romantic kisses in cinema. Mm-hmm. And we've seen the evolution of this whole scene with Keaton's, you know, his actions and his thought process. Nothing happens just incidentally.
Yeah, and I mean, I do like that relationship. I mean, especially compared to someone like Chaplin, who tends to sentimentalize the love interests in his films. She's not sentimentalized here, and even the kiss, you know, it's this coming together of their relationship, but it's also this very hairy kiss in the middle of all of this activity, and it just seems to kind of keep with the pace of the film. There's not like violin music that's going to start playing at that particular moment.
Exactly. And there's more fun to come in the final moments of The General. Welcome back to the Pickford Classic Movie. You've just finished watching Buster Keaton's The General, his masterpiece from 1926, and it really is a masterpiece. And unfortunately, though, when it came out, both the public reaction and the critical reaction, it wasn't even really mixed. It was fairly negative.
Right. I just think people didn't know what to make of it. You know, they thought, reviewers thought that it didn't know whether it wanted to be a kind of action stunt movie or a clown comedy, and they couldn't accept it as a hybrid of those two, so they sort of rejected it.
And once they rejected The General, Hollywood essentially rejected Buster Keaton, because The General was a very expensive film. It cost something like $400,000, which today's dollars would make it about a $50 million movie.
And especially that train
the amazing jaw-dropping train sequence, which I'm sure everybody realizes that was a real bridge and that was a real train, and it was sitting at the bottom of the river for like 20 years. So,
right.
I mean, these stunts were not cheap. The film was very expensive. But really, I mean, Buster Keaton never got the chance to really have creative autonomy again in the rest of his career.
But time has definitely fallen in favor of this movie, and it has endured, and that's part of the reason that that we're showing it here on the show.
And some of his other great films would be?
I would say Sherlock Jr., probably, a brilliant film from around the same time, yeah.
And any other silent films that you would recommend people check out?
Well, I mean, maybe not a silent film, maybe a film that really shows Buster Keaton's legacy, his influence. And another Pickford classic movie, Mr. Who Loves Holiday, by Jacques Tati. You know, Tati is one of the people in the sound period who is one of the great heirs of Buster Keaton's style, and that whole process of thinking through a set as a kind of puzzle, you see that in Tati's movies as well.
Yeah, Tati is not Chaplin-esque. He's very much Keaton. There's physical comedy, but it's the physical comedy you have to think about. And Hulot's Holiday is absolutely one of my favorite films of all time. So make sure you look for M. Hulot's Holiday, and we'll see you next week on the Pickford Classic Movie.